So you love podcasts, and you want to listen to more amazing content, but you have no idea what to listen to. And your friends keep telling you about great episodes, yet you can never remember what they told you. Well, here's the answer. Good Pods. It's the social app dedicated to podcasts where your friends, podcast listeners, and favorite podcast hosts all come together to share on their feeds what they recommend and what they listen to. You can connect to others, bookmark episodes, start a conversation about the episode, connect to the hosts, and most importantly, listen to great podcasts right in the Good Pods app. Download Good Pods wherever you get your apps and start sharing with a community that loves to listen. Good Pods, it's where to connect and listen.
It's a good news, bad news thing. The good news about social isolation is that you pay $250 less at the gas pump last month and $375 less going out to eat. The bad news is that your grocery bill is now $1,585 and your pay-per-view bill is over $200. Solution? Put down the ice cream and listen to classic episodes of Thrive Loud.
Get ready to thrive loud with Lou Diamond.
Welcome, everyone, to another episode of Thrive Loud with Lou Diamond, connecting you to the most inspiring and amazing people that are thriving each and every day. I'm your host, Lou Diamond. Today on Thrive Loud, we have a business advisor, attorney, and legal coach for online entrepreneurs. She provides legal protection for online content, programs, and IP. She's the host of the Guts, Grit, and Great Business podcast, which I'm sure you'll be listening to after hearing her on this episode. She likes showing up, standing up, and speaking up. Thrive Loud listeners, Heather Pearce Campbell. Heather, how are you today?
I'm doing so well. Thank you for that awesome intro, Lou.
Thrive Loud listeners need to know that I met Heather in kind of like one of those big Zoom group meetings. I'd heard of her name from some other folks in our industry, heard her speak, and there were two things that went through my mind. One, I had to have her on Thrive Loud and have her connect and share her story to our listeners. And two, I'm going to be in incredible negotiations to try to get her to do some more voiceover work because she has like a great time. So Heather, if you could, how did this become your gig, helping people really take the legal components of these entrepreneurs in business and help them organize, get themselves set up? How did this become your specialty?
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Well, one is, you know, and my path goes way back. My heart for entrepreneurs, my own entrepreneurial path goes way back. But after 12 or 13 years of practicing law, I could see, and I've always considered myself a little bit of an outsider in the traditional legal market, meaning that and I've said this before, I'm really a business person that happens to be in law.
Okay.
And so it's a great intersection for a couple of my main loves. But I also have been keenly aware pretty much since day one about how poorly the traditional legal industry does in certain regards, and especially around meeting needs of certain segments of the marketplace. And this became just more and more clear the longer that I practiced. But at about 12 or 13 years, I really wanted to create a shift in how I supported people. And being that my love for entrepreneurship really from a legal perspective, you know, is larger than anything else. And the fact that entrepreneurs are largely, you know, underserved or not well served at all by the traditional legal market, I just decided I need to create a whole new model. I need to show up where these people already are. And when I say the entrepreneurs that I serve, I call them information entrepreneurs. They're coaches, consultants, online educators, speakers, authors. They don't tend to go to the traditional legal marketplace the way that other business consumers of legal services do. And so I just thought, you know, I need to meet them where they are. I need to educate them where they are, help them to become a more strategic version of themselves so that they consume legal services to create more successful businesses.
Very cool. And so needed, Heather. Let me just make this clear that every possible thing you just said about how a small entrepreneur or solopreneur or business, they hit this stuff. And there's like a line that's drawn, right, on what regular law firms can provide and what you can get as
a small entrepreneur and who wants to do the business. And a lot of it has to do with, I guess, cost and value. Yes. I guess what I want to ask is, how are you able to take all that big legal stuff and drive it down to give it the value that smaller businesses, younger businesses could take advantage of?
Yeah, well, great question. And there's a couple ways that I've approached it. So there's the way that I primarily think about it is, and if you look, I tell people, just imagine that you're standing in front of a huge whiteboard, right? And on the left-hand side, clear over here to the very left edge, is traditional law firms. And, you know, that's one choice in the marketplace. And then you go clear over here to the right side, and you have what I call big box document template stores, yeah. Right? You know who I'm talking about. But there's all this white space in the middle where there largely have been like zero legal service providers outside of, you know, what I will call solo and small practitioners. But even then, the time trade-off and the cost trade-off to a consumer of legal services can still be too high, meaning that the way that businesses evolve for information entrepreneurs is that it's this kind of sideways route into business. They don't start out generally with a business plan or a legal budget or advisors on their team, right? It's a very different pathway into business. And so you've got all this white space in the middle. And I looked at that and I said, gosh, you know, not everybody in the business world are my people, but there's a certain segment of the marketplace that I can serve very, very well. And I really designed services for that segment. So this is for the information entrepreneurs, right? Small brick and mortar businesses, people who are in the products world that are in manufacturing, et cetera, those are not my people. For the most part, you know, not for this service. And although I've worked with plenty of brick and mortar businesses, I really got very, very specific about who I'm here to serve. And so the ways that I've approached providing legal services to this niche is, one, I wanted to create bundled education and documents. The documents are critical, but the education is even more transformational than the documents. Mm-hmm. So I see the documents as a tool. But the leader of a business, even a small business, even a solo entrepreneur has to lead his or her own business. They need, just like you had, if you go into business for yourself and you never plan to learn marketing or sales or technology, right? People end up having to learn those things applied to their business. Legal is one more of those things. You have to have a certain amount of legal chops to be able to successfully lead your business in the current marketplace, especially in the online world, which I call the Wild West of business. Mm-hmm. And so my goal was to really boil down the essentials for people in this space into education and legal tools that are consumable and quickly consumable so that they could get up to speed quickly and not have to work one-on-one with a law firm for all of their services, in part because it's a done-for-you product. And most attorneys are not up for the time that it takes to educate and transform a client.
So Heather, let me just get this straight. You've done all the legwork to figure out the majority of the work that most companies need from that legal perspective of the stuff that they need to do to get their business running. Mm-hmm. You teach them how to deal with all the issues, and you're doing it obviously at a much more cost-effective basis than if you had to go hire an attorney to figure this out from scratch and deal with it and not get the attention you'd want because you were probably, quote unquote, too small of a client.
That's right. Yes. And massively, it's a little bit like, I mean, the way that I think of it, and it could be the wrong term, is a little bit like crowdsourcing legal, right?
Yes.
Like having the collectives paid less for a service that they would pay, you know, easily 10 to 20 times the value of if they went to the traditional legal marketplace, but being able to take it to the marketplace in numbers that make sense, like, which is why I do a lot of group teaching, right? I show up to groups, and these are groups of similarly situated entrepreneurs, so that they can run through my workshops together. They consume the legal services at a much significantly reduced rate, like significantly reduced rate. And then, but they're so niched, they're so on target, the people that I serve, like their businesses all essentially look the same way. They're doing the same things inside of their businesses. They may be at different phases. They might be adding some of the other things later, but they all need essentially the same education and the same support.
Yeah, Heather, let's give one example of one of the things that they would learn from both the program and the offerings that you package for them, put together.
Yeah, absolutely. So for example, just a couple weekends ago, I delivered two back-to-back workshops, and this was following a large group presentation that I'd done, actually several group presentations. But, you know, I had about 25 or 30 people enrolled in a workshop. They paid easily less than 1/10 of what they would pay to work with an attorney for. And that even is really conservative. Like my goal is that people, first of all, can afford it and quickly move on it, meaning that they don't have to finance it. They don't have to do things right. that, you know, other people might have to do to actually afford traditional legal services. And within a couple of weeks, we turn it around and they're in a workshop, buns and seats, actually learning how to lead their business differently. So we had both the website protection package workshop, and then I did one specific to JVs and affiliates. So let's just take the affiliate program, for example. People walked away knowing three proactive steps they should take ahead of implementing an affiliate program that is drastically going to help them reduce their risk. Affiliate programs bring a lot of risk because you have people right. running around in the world saying things on behalf of your business, enrolling people into services, right? Emailing their own databases that they maybe didn't build in compliance with the CAN-SPAM Act or the GDPR, which is a privacy regulation that governs internationally, right?
Mm-hmm.
So
showing, flexing your muscles here. I like it. I like it. Showing, them, showing well, how smart you are between the ears. I like it. Our listeners do too.
But those are some big ways that people can get into trouble. And if you've got affiliates that have built their database the wrong way and now suddenly are emailing their entire database with an offer from your business, you're on the hook for what they say, whether they bring risk in the door, right? And so anyways, there's a whole workshop that I've put together that trains people about how to, you know, put in place their affiliate program agreement and how to also run an affiliate program that will reduce the risk that something goes wrong.
I love hearing this, and mostly because there's been a spinoff of my own company that my wife actually runs, which isn't on the legal side, which is actually more on the chief administrative officing accounting mm-hmm. side of the world,
yep.
which is very cool that you're taking on this this initiative. What I do want to ask you is a challenge that you had, because obviously you've built the underlying material, the content, the, mm-hmm. the coursework and all of that. As you were packaging this stuff together, that in itself, as you being your own business and starting your own company mm-hmm. and helping to put your own stuff, were you able to put your work into practice, I guess? Because obviously it's always really hard for the sharpest knife, really can't even shave its own handle. So how did you tackle your own business in putting this all together?
Yeah, great question. So here's the irony is that even though the majority of folks that I serve are obviously in the information and online world, right? The first many years of building my own legal practice and actually the first few years of building my quote unquote, my second brand, the Legal Website Warrior, which is a whole separate business, I did this the good old fashioned way, relationship building, phone yep. calls, one-on-one, you know, and that's how both of those businesses grew. And so, yes, the answer is I have had to then, you know, build my own online presence, build out my own website, get all of this stuff in place that I do for other people. And it was truthfully a great exercise. You know, even having now my own affiliate program agreement, like I got to build, first of all, most of these documents though are built for people that have really thriving businesses. So, you know, I was working with some of my ideal clients in the marketplace, and these are folks that anybody that's listening would recognize. And I, you know, even before I launched my second website, right? And so I got the experience of building out this documentation to support multi-million dollar businesses, people that really had grown quickly and had thriving online businesses, their coaches, consultants, their New York Times bestselling authors, their speakers, they do all the things. And the exciting part is knowing how robust these documents are, being able to take them to a marketplace and provide them you know, to people at large who are building businesses that hopefully will scale to that level. They're maybe getting started and they're earlier on the path, but they're committed to their success, right? And along the way, I got to stair step the implementation into my own business as I built out an online website, an online funnel, an affiliate program for my legal education and information business, right? So I've had the chance to basically treat my own business as a playground as well.
Nice. You got to practice what you preach, which is
awesome. That's right.
So as we're here today, the question I have for you is, at the time we're recording this, which is mid-July, we are a little bit into the launch of your podcast program.
Yeah.
You want to share with the listeners a little bit about Guts, Grit, and Great Business.
Totally. So this has been a super fun, kind of surprising thing that has come out of this year. And part of it is I realized in COVID, right, that I was experiencing a whole bunch of creative energy and I needed to funnel it. And I'm also, like so many parents, extraordinarily time strapped. So it was caught between this place of like really wanting to create something and also having very, very limited time. And yet somehow, right, I went through a podcast course with some wonderful mutual friends, and from, you know, 0 to 4 weeks, I went from not even understanding like all the things that it takes to get a podcast off the ground to essentially having one fully launched, you know, and to date, and that's only been live like basically 4 weeks now, a couple days over 4 weeks. And I've got 25 or 30 recordings finished, edited, and lined up that basically populate my podcast through the end of this year.
Isn't that exciting? Isn't that fun?
Oh my gosh. And it's been so much fun. The Guts, Grit, and Great Business theme. I mean, it's one that I care a lot about. And especially right now, I just thought, you know, I know there's a lot of folks out there, including people that I serve, that are having to make changes in their business, that are having to like show up in whole new ways as parents. They're having to do all this stuff. And we get to do it all at the same time. And the theme for me, really, whether it's around entrepreneurship, around business, or in life, is that it's a marathon, not a sprint. And we just get to keep reminding ourselves that having a long-term perspective will help us. And, you know, grit, I just think, is essential to success anywhere in life. And so I love the theme. I love having conversations about this. I've had some fascinating people on my podcast, and it's been super enjoyable.
So I love to peel back the curtain a little bit and share with the listeners a little more about you. And I do it in a unique way, Heather. And that is, I love, look what you've got going. You've got two businesses going, multiple websites, a new podcast. You've got young children that you're helping to spread peanut butter and jelly sandwiches on all day long and peanut butter with your fingers. And, to the audience, something that happened right before we started. Right. And on you're kicking on all cylinders, which is awesome. But as you know and mentioned, there are days when you're not quite thriving, when you have trouble thriving. Who or what practice do you seek to get yourself back on the thriving track?
I love that. So, you know, I think the first one is actually what I just mentioned, is really when I'm struggling and I'm feeling extraordinarily pinched or tight, or like I'm just not showing up well enough on that day, or not getting all the things done. That's a common one for me right now. Just not feeling like I can do all the things. Is really shifting the timeline of my perspective about like, okay, what's happening today? What really matters today versus tomorrow versus next month versus long-term thinking, and remembering that, you know, it's a little bit, when I think back, for example, of what happened during my law school experience, my mom was diagnosed, she had terminal brain cancer and she passed away 10 months later. And this was my first year of law school.
Tough.
It really shifted my perspective around things that are going wrong and like whether something would stress me out, for example. And life took on such a different, like my viewpoint on life shifted so dramatically. Law school was this thing I did in the background, and life really took the front seat. And I remember like law school exams, like things that were pretty heavy and stressful for other people, like just didn't stress me out. You know, I'd pack a picnic and I'd sit there and have cheddar and salmon and, you know, take my exam. Like really, seriously. And I remember thinking, like, unless I'm dying or somebody that I love is dying, I just don't have the capacity to be stressed out about it. And I've had to reflect back, like, in current times right now, the level of stress is high for a lot of people.
Yeah.
And the reality is we do have a really significant threat to our health, especially to people that we love, you know, anybody in any of the risk categories. But what it means is that, like, so for example, I woke up this morning to both of my children waking ahead of me and opening a bag of Cheetos, that, like, organic Cheetos. We don't do dairy in our house, but every once in a while I splurge. They found it and had it everywhere, all over the toy room, all over the sofa, right? And then they'd also found toys. They both have birthdays close together that daddy had hid in his closet, and they opened all the toys. Like, it was just chaos, right? But I remember just sitting and having my tea this morning and just thinking, like, you know what? This is life during COVID. It's okay. So what? Cheetos are a total mess and they're everywhere. So what? Like, toys are opened. Oh, well. And I think just, like, having the long-term perspective of, like, is this really stressful? No, it's not. Not compared to what really matters. And so for me, it's really just thinking about and re-examining what stress is and whether or not we really need to feel that stress.
Love it. Let's do this. Let's do the admin part of the show, if you could, Heather. Share with the listeners all the places people can find you, websites, social media, all that fun stuff. We will put it all in the show notes. However, it always gets more engagement when they hear it directly from you.
Yeah, absolutely. So I'm a big fan of LinkedIn. I've connected with almost 5,000 people there, and it's all been one-on-one, and I invite everybody into a phone call. And some people take me up on it. Anyways, I love LinkedIn. If you're there, let's connect. I can also be found on Facebook. You can just search my name, Heather Pearce Campbell. Pearce is P-E-A-R-C-E, so it's the more unusual spelling. But you can find me on LinkedIn. You can find me on Facebook, both on my business page or personal page. And then, you know, my website's a great place to get in touch. I've got a contact form. Those emails get through to my VA, who helps me keep eyeballs on everything. So that my website address is just legalwebsitewarrior, just how it sounds, .com.
Love it. Permission to go down fun street with you.
Totally.
Okay. So for years, the signature question on this show has evolved for, we ask our guests to pick their all-time favorite movie. And the listeners need to know this, that we do this in a form ahead of the episode. So I send it out to the guests and the guests fill it out, but no one has ever done what you did, which was, she didn't just say, well, I can't just pick one. I don't know. No, she wrote just one. Okay. Forget that. Here's five. Can you share with the listeners your five all-time favorite movies?
Oh my gosh, hilarious. So I can remember three of them. I couldn't find the form.
I'll fill them out.
Yes. Yeah. So there's a couple, and this will, for anybody that grew up during the same era that I did, and I'll just say the quick caveat is that I was one of six kids. And so the rules around movies in our house is that generally they had to be, you know, G or maybe PG. And all six of us had to be able to watch it, right? So We grew up with movies like What About Bob and The Princess Bride. And the hilarious thing is, if you were to be with me and any of my siblings and watch one of these movies, like, it's even funnier now than it was then. But we all know literally, like, every line of each of those movies.
I'm certain. For the listeners, they should know. Yes, those are the first two. What About Bob, The Princess Bride, and here are the other three. It's a Wonderful Life.
Oh,
A Roman Holiday.
Yes.
And Wonder Woman, which was, like, that came out of left field.
Totally. That's my more. It's so good. That was the first movie that I went to after I had my daughter. And I almost did not survive having my daughter.
Oh my goodness.
And so that was a really significant thing for me, to go spend 2 or 3 hours by myself and sit in a theater and watch that movie. And it was like total goosebumps and tears and all the things. So yes, I love Wonder Woman, but I also grew up watching the original Wonder Woman.
Yes. Linda Carter.
Totally.
Salute out to all of you. So, so here's what we call the fun street speed round, if you would. And we're going to have fun with this, where you've seen Family Feud, and you know, at the end where they ask, like, your questions that we surveyed a top 100 people, we're only surveying you.
Oh, okay.
So I'm going to ask it, and whatever comes to your mind, these are things that make you feel good, that come to mind right away, and we'll let it roll. So you ready?
Okay, ready.
I know you got it in you. Okay. A song that pumps you up and makes you feel great.
Oh my gosh. So I have the worst memory for names of songs, but there, the one that comes to mind is the, I'm not even going to know the title of it. I know how it sounds. It's about today being the best day of your life.
We'll come back to that.
Yes, the modern one. I know you're going to regret this one.
It's all right. A favorite food that's not a dessert.
Oh, favorite food. I mean, I'll start with peanut butter, but it's because it's everywhere in my life right now. And I love it. So I can't complain.
Favorite food that is a dessert.
Right now, my favorite is sorbet, mango sorbet.
I like it. Activity you wish you did more of.
Oh my goodness. Walking and exercising. Right now during COVID, it's like, you know, there's definitely a bit of an entrapment feeling.
Okay. Activity you wish you did less of.
Currently work. That's pretty broad and I love my work, but the scheduling part of it, like I'm regularly up until 1 or 2 in the morning right now.
If you can snap your fingers and go anywhere, where are you?
Probably Sedona.
I like it. Mm-hmm. Heather Campbell. First of all, thank you for taking us down Fun Street. We'll come back and figure out what that song is.
What the song was. I'll ask my 2-year-old daughter. She'd ask be able to tell daughter. Me.
Yes. Odds are we'll play it underneath us to kick us out of here if we could ever figure out what it is, but we'll find
it.
And with that, so excited to meet you. Guts, grit, and great business. I love it. Love what you're doing with your business. Hopefully you had a little bit of fun here today, you know, getting away from some of the peanut butter spreading that you had to deal with.
Oh my gosh. It was so great, Lou.
And to all our listeners out there, thank you for joining us. And until next time, keep thriving onward and upward. And remember, be brief, be bright, be gone. This is gonna be the best day of my life. This is gonna be the best day of my life.
You've been listening to Thrive Loud with your host, Lou Diamond. Check us out on the web at thriveloud.com and follow us on Instagram, LinkedIn, Twitter, and Facebook at Thrive Loud. And check us out on the Good Pods app at Thrive Loud, where you can follow, listen, and connect directly to Lou and all of the Thrive Loud episodes. Thanks for listening.